Thank you. Bless the Lord, O my soul. All that is within me, bless his holy name. Have you done that already? Have you done that this morning? Has your whole being been engaged in blessing the Lord to praise his holy name? Psalm 103. I'm going to go ahead and ask you to be seated. I'm going to read this psalm right now. I was going to read it later. But as I was worshiping up here, I thought, you know, we need to read that now. I'm reading it from the New International Version, which has different words. Different words. But it says, praise the Lord, my soul, all my inmost being. Praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Hallelujah. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. The life of mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower of a field. The wind blows over it, and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. Praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, who obey his word. Praise the Lord, all his heavenly hosts, you his servants, you who do his will. Praise the Lord, all his works, everywhere in his dominion. Praise the Lord, my soul. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. We're going to go to prayer this morning. And as we do, we have prayer requests to bring before the Lord, and there are many. Our list seems to be growing, and we want to remember all these requests. We don't mention every single prayer request. They are in the bulletin if we know them, in the prayer list, and encourage you to take the prayer list and use that as a daily prayer guide. Don't just throw the bulletin away when you go home, but take that prayer list and use it as a prayer guide throughout the week to pray for these needs. We want to remember Linda, who had emergency surgery this past week on her appendix. We want to pray for Dave, who needs help as well, for Justin and Michelle. I want to lift up Michelle to you. Michelle needs our prayers today, especially needs our prayers. So let's keep her in prayer. Michelle's a precious, precious member of our church, and we want to lift her up to the Lord. Because we know, didn't we just read, forget none of his benefits, he heals all our diseases, He's a healer. He's a great healer, amen? Does anybody doubt that this morning? If you doubt that he can heal, please don't pray. Don't pray for someone's healing if you doubt that he can do it. Because I know he can. I know he can. Let's pray. Let's pray together. Join our hearts together. Our Father in heaven, we bow before you this morning. We love you. We love you. You are an awesome God. Father, we bless your name. We bless your holy name with everything that's in us this morning. In our minds and our hearts, in even our physical bodies, we worship you and bless your name. You are so worthy. You have done great things. We remember them. We know in the past the great things you have done. We worship you because there's none like you. There's no one else like you. Oh, how we praise you today. How we praise your name. Father, I pray for every single person in this auditorium right now. I pray for everyone watching by live stream this morning. I pray for those who will be watching a video of this service later on at their convenience. I pray for each one who is engaged in worshiping you by whichever medium there is. I pray that we would engage with you, that we would know you, that we would experience you in our lives. Not merely come to church, not merely sing songs, not merely listen to a sermon, not merely just being here, but Father, we would connect with you, that we would know you and know more about you, and our lives would not be the same, because each time we encounter you, we would grow and change and be different. Lord, we're gathered here right now. We know we live in a world that's so needy. You know that. You knew from the very beginning in the creation of the world that it would get to be like this, and it will get probably worse. And you know that. Father, you told us not to despair about that, but you told us to pray. And we pray for those in authority over us. We pray for those in governments, not only in our own country, but around the world. We pray, Father, for those who make decisions that affect us and oftentimes go against your values and the biblical values that we are so accustomed to. God, I just pray for our country. I pray for our country right now. I pray for our president. He may recover from COVID. We give him health. Give him good health. Draw him to yourself, Father, I pray. May he be sensitive to the promptings of the powerful Holy Spirit, who I know cares about what's happening in the world today and in our country. We pray for our armed forces around the world. God, they need you. Many of them do not know you as Savior. Those who do, we pray and give them boldness and opportunity to share their faith. We pray, Father, that you would protect all of them and keep them safe. We pray for those who are serving you around the world as missionaries. We think of the ones that are bulletin insert, the ones we support, and then there's the millions that we don't even know by name or where they are. But you know them. You know every missionary, whether they be in a big city and maybe even in a cross-cultural place in our own country or around the world where the difficulty to share their faith is strong. I pray, Father, for them. Give them what they need physically, emotionally, spiritually, and their health. We pray for the national churches around the world. We pray for them as they worship you as we worship you here. That the people that they lead would engage with you as well. Father, we pray for those who are being persecuted today for their faith. We cannot imagine what they're going through. We hear about, we hear the stories, we hear testimonies, but Father, we find it sometimes hard to relate to that because we have such freedom here. And we claim our rights to worship, which we have in our country, but we may not always have it. So Father, I pray today that you would be with them as they are sometimes imprisoned, deprived of basic needs, separated from families, subject to organized criminal activity against them, as in Colombia that we read today. Father, I just ask you to be with every believer, every brother and sister in Christ that follows you, that they may have peace and encouragement. And I pray for us who are blessed. I pray, Father, that we today might realize that we too have risks in our faith and draw to yourself for your strength and your help. Lord, we pray for those we mentioned this morning who need prayer. So many on our list, Father, we didn't mention them all. We know that we could go on and on with a list like this. You know the ones who need prayer. You already know the outcome. That's what's exciting. You already know how it's going to turn out. We don't know that, and we have to put our trust in you right now. We pray for Linda as she recovers from her surgery. We pray for Dave. We pray for Justin as he has more tests. We pray for others who are recovering from surgeries and going to be going through therapy. We pray, Father, for strength for them. We pray for Michelle today. Father God, I would pray that you just reach down right now and touch her where she is. Father, I just pray that you would just perform your work on her body. You know what she needs. You know everything about her. You formed her in her mother's womb. You watched her being knitted together. And all these years that she's been alive, you've watched her live out her faith. You've watched her follow you. Today I just pray that you would strengthen her. We would pray that you perform a miracle in her body, because that's not too much for you. That's not beyond the possibilities. So we pray for Michelle right now. In Jesus' name. In the precious name of Jesus. We pray for all of our needy folks. Whatever need they have, we pray for your will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, right now I just pray that you continue to be with us as we worship you. Lord, we're here for this point of time to engage with you. I pray that we'll do that. In Jesus' precious name, amen. In case you haven't noticed, there's something different going on in Genesis. Every year we come in on this Sunday and we find out that the committee's been at work and ready to go. Vacation Bible School starts tonight. And you're going to hear about that, some more about that in a couple minutes. But be praying for Bible School if you're not directly involved in it. Be praying for it. Prayer is the best thing we can do. To pray for these kids to come, that they might find Jesus, they may know Jesus, they learn about Jesus. They may go to 10 different Bible schools, that's okay. But someday they're going to be in heaven because someone cared enough to pray for them. So be one of those prayers, would you please? Please read the bulletin announcements. They're there for you to read, and I'm not going to mention them all. So just be sure that you are aware of what's going on. And the rest of the week, a lot of activity here at the church. And if you aren't involved with Bible School, come down on Thursday night at least see the product. As we have our outdoor carnival, pray the rain holds off and stays close to us. So we're going to pray that that is the case. We have a good time this week at Vacation Bible School. Ushers, we wait upon us for our morning offering of tithes and gifts. Lord, you've been so good to us. You provide for our needs. Don't always have our wants, but we have our needs. And you've given us the ability even to be here today. You've provided those things for us, and we believe that your word teaches us to give back to you from what you give to us out of a cheerful heart, because we love you, and it's not something we do grudgingly. We want to give back to you. So receive this offering from those who give it. Bless them. Bless the gift and make it sufficient to do your work as you've called us, this church, to be here in Mahoning Town, in Newcastle, and around the world through missions. And pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
It's time to look up. There's more to life than what's on your screen. adventure of a lifetime and experience the greatness of God's love.
A.W. Tozer said, "What comes to mind when we think about God is the most important thing about us." Now I know that that needs to be repeated. Let it sink in a little bit. What comes to mind when we think about God is the most important thing about us. What are you thinking about God? Who is God in your mind? Our worship of God will never be greater than what we think about God. Let me give you two examples. If God is primarily there to answer our wish list, then we'll worship him only when it's convenient. When we need something, oh, we'll worship him. I grew up in a neighborhood with a lady who was not a regular churchgoer, but you would think she was by the way she talked. She didn't go to church a lot, but I found during the times of growing up that every time her pet dog died, it died once at a time, but every time she had a dog that died, she'd go back to church. And she'd go to church for a few weeks and then she'd drop off again. When we want something or need something, we worship God when it's convenient. Or the other example would be this. If we primarily see God as a demanding and vengeful God, we will keep our distance from him. We'll keep him at a distance. because we feel that he's just out there to zap us when we do something wrong or to do bad things in our life. And I don't know how many times it grieves me to think of how many times people have said, you know, God did this, blame God for the bad things that go on in the world. God is good. God is good all the time. All the time. Someone has said that the 103rd Psalm very well may be the most complete picture of God's character that we have. And as we read that earlier, I hope that you let some of that kind of register with you. Worship is really praising God's holy name. The 103rd Psalm begins with an outburst of praise. Bless the Lord, David says. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. To bless the Lord is more than just to praise him. That's probably a hair-splitting definition, but it really goes beyond just praising him. You know, a lot of times I praise the Lord because something good happened, and I'll say, oh, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. That's so exciting. You know, look what God did. And we should do that. I'm not saying I'm wrong or you're wrong if you do that. That's not the point. But when we talk about blessing the Lord, when we say, bless the Lord, oh my soul, what we're doing is more than just praising him for something he did, but we're acknowledging with affection and with gratitude who he is. Because God does great things. As the song said that we sang earlier, he has done great things. We bless the Lord because of who he is and how he relates to us. How does he relate to you right now? How is he relating to me? How is he relating in our lives? Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. In this psalm, we find out that worship is all about who God is. And we've been talking about worship the last couple of Sundays, especially from the Psalms. And we'll have a couple more about worship specifically in the weeks to come. But worship begins with God. Worship begins with who he is. And as David wrote this, he is saying to himself, he is addressing himself. He says, self, self, bless the Lord, oh my soul, with all that I am, I bless the Lord. With our whole nature, our intellect, our emotions, our physical being. I'm not into physical demonstrations of worship. I know some people look at that as a measure of our worship. I do not. I've said for most of my pastoral tenure of nearly 49 years, if you want to raise your hands or sit on your hands, I don't care. Just worship the Lord. It's not a matter of if you stand when you worship or sit when you worship. It doesn't matter if you run the aisles or don't run the aisles. It doesn't matter if you're reserved or if you're very demonstrative. That does not measure your worship. Worship is, it begins with God, and as diligent worshipers that we are to be, you and I are to be not just worshipers, I put that word in there on purpose, as diligent worshipers, coming to church on Sunday morning, getting up on Monday morning, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and worshiping the Lord, putting on that music in the car, on the car radio or whatever device you're using nowadays, Biden got Trump. We're talking about record players during the campaign. I know we're getting back at a new era with the MP3 MP3 and whatever initials and all that kind of stuff that the young folk talk about. When you listen to the music, you bless the Lord, you praise Him. As diligent worshipers, we train our souls to praise the Lord. Regardless of how we feel, regardless of what we get out of it, regardless of when we walk out of church and, you know, I have people say sometimes, you know, I just didn't feel like God was there today. Let me clue you in. He was. He was here. He doesn't never not come. Because you've heard me say before, we bring Him with us, right? God is everywhere all the time. So you can't blame Him if the worship falls flat in your mind, because if it happens that way, it's because we have not engaged. We have not engaged Him as we should. It's all about Him. It's not about the worship team and things like what songs we sang. I didn't like that song. I don't like that song. I don't really much care if you like the song or not. If it's a song of worship that helps us worship God, that's why we sing it. We're not singing it for you. We're not singing it for our own entertainment, our own edification. We're singing it because we're singing it to God. God, You are wonderful. Just think back on what we sang this morning. I worship You, Almighty God. There's none like You. He wants to hear us say that. I want to be careful. I'm going to start preaching here this morning. Worship Him. Tell Him how great He is. It's all about Him. As diligent worshipers, we praise the Lord rather than merely making requests of Him. I'm guilty of it. You are guilty of it. We are all guilty of coming to God in the quickness of our prayer time and saying, oh God, give me this, give me that. I need this, I need that. We all do it, don't we? And if we ever catch ourselves, which we should, we do, then we say, oh, forgive me, Lord, I didn't mean to do that. But when we pray, when we come to the Lord, when we engage with Him, we first of all praise Him rather than just ask for the requests. He wants us to make our requests known to Him. Don't get me wrong. Don't split the hair here so that it's an either-or thing. God wants us to make our requests known to Him. But He also enjoys hearing us tell Him how great He is. And so when you spend your time in private worship, or we come together in corporate worship, we are telling Him how great He is and all of His wonderful attributes. He's done great things. Forget not all of His benefits. There's so many. Worship remembers what we have instead of what we lack. When we come to worship Him and we tell God how great He is and we remember His benefits, it's helpful to remember all He's given to us. It's interesting that we have so much. With our experiences in Guatemala, we come back to the States, and anybody who's been to some of these developing countries around the world, the poorest person in the United States is wealthy in comparison to these people in those countries. We have so much. We are so blessed. We take it for granted. We are so entitled to it that if we don't get it, we don't get what we want. When we want it, we complain to God. Songwriter, that old hymn, count your blessings, name them one by one. What does it say? And it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Amen? Just count your blessings. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. And he lists them. David lists them here in the psalm. He says he forgives all our iniquities. Folks, if God has done nothing else, if he never does anything else for you or for me, he has forgiven our sins. I heard a little weak amen. He's forgiven you. He's forgiven me. Had he not forgiven us, we only have one destiny, and that is eternal hell fire. Right? Am I right? But he has forgiven us. He has forgiven us all of our sins, all of our iniquities. It's the greatest of all his benefits to us. He heals all our diseases. Healing is another of God's greatest blessings. We pray this morning for the healing of bodies. We pray for God's healing because God is a healer. He's the great physician. We know that. Some of you, myself included, have experienced divine healing in our lives. It's great to know that God heals us, but not everyone is healed the way we would like. And sometimes the ultimate healing happens when our life on this earth is done and we're ushered into the presence of Jesus. And the people that have had the greatest struggle with their health and passed on to glory are standing before the throne now completely better, completely healed. He heals all of our diseases. He redeems our life from destruction and replaces it with his loving kindness and tender mercies. God works according to his perfect will, saving us from being destroyed. If God does the work that we let him do, he protects our lives. Romans 8, verse 28, the verse that's quoted and misquoted, taken out of context and all kinds of stuff, says this: "And we know that all things work together for good," all things work together for good, "to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose." God knows best. God knows it all. And he redeems our life from the pit and then crowns us, it says in Psalm 103, he crowns us with loving kindness and tender mercy. His loving kindness, we sang it last week, his loving kindness is better than life. The mercies of the Lord are new every morning. We sing the hymn, "Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Great is your faithfulness, O Lord, to me." God's mercies are new every day. Fourthly, he says that he satisfies our mouth with good things. Now, that word mouth there probably is not the best rendition, according to the scholars. It is better rendered the desire or enjoyment. And if you put that in another way of saying it, you say, he satisfies our desires. What do you desire today? Well, I desire to hit the lottery. I desire to have a vacation home in the south of France. Well, I desire to have a new Tesla electric vehicle. Yeah, those aren't the desires we need to have, are they? We desire what he wants for us, and he gives us He gives us our reasonable desires to enjoy. And Paul, the Apostle Paul said, I have learned how to be content with what God has given me. Have you? Have I? Are we able to walk out here today and say, you know what? I have all that I need. I'm content with what God has given me. How humble my home or how humble my vehicle might be, I'm content with what God has given me. That's what he does. He satisfies our desires. He gives us the enjoyment so that our youth is renewed like the eagle, giving us strength like the eagle. Some of us this morning, some of you saying, where did that eagle go? Where is that eagle? I'm not feeling much strength right now. The Bible said in Isaiah, those that wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They will rise up with wings as the eagle. They will run and not be weary. They will walk and not faint. And the promise of Scripture. It's the Scripture's promise to us. Worship is all about God. But worship acknowledges what God thinks of us. Do you know what God thinks of you? God has you on his mind. You may feel insignificant at times. We may think that, who am I? Who am I? God thinks about us. Someone said this. I don't know how trite it may sound, but I always liked it. Someone had said it a couple ways. One way was, if God had a refrigerator, your picture would be on it. I like that. I don't think God has a refrigerator. Believe me, I'm not teaching heresy here. I don't believe he has a refrigerator, but I believe that if he did, he'd have a picture right there. Or someone put it another way, if he carried a wallet, which I know he doesn't have to worry about that either, your picture would be in it. Because God is thinking about you. He's thinking about me. He never forgets us. God has a special relationship with us. He says in verse 6 that he works for the oppressed. His righteous acts care for those who are oppressed. As I was preparing this message this week, I'm looking at this, I'm thinking, God loves the underdog, doesn't he? When Jesus came to earth, those who were the elite of society, he was very judgmental towards. He was very open about criticizing what they were doing, because they were oppressing those who had need, and he talked about justice and all those things. The life of Christ, the life of a Christ follower, is to care for those who are oppressed, to care for those who don't have what we have. And as I mentioned earlier, even the poorest of us are richer than some countries, some people in some countries. And so we have ways that we can reach out and help our fellow man here on earth. We can offer them food when they need it. So glad that 13 years ago we began a food pantry at this church, and it's going strong. It's going strong. I don't think it will ever end. Lord willing. Because I think we're doing a great work. In the past year and a half, we've been able to offer goods, donated goods, a small amount of money to help replenish the pantry. But people can come and get things. And there are people who have come and they don't have anything. And touch base with Frida. They come in and they just, whatever you need, just go ahead and take. And they give them stuff. It's wonderful, isn't it? But that's what a Christ follower does. That's what a church ought to be doing. We're not buying private jets to jet around the country and speak engagements. Not that anybody would come if I went and spoke anywhere, but you don't do that kind of stuff, do we? We're reaching out to meet the needs of people right here where God has planted us. Almost 30 years ago, God brought this church down here to Huntington to serve this community. He not only works for the oppressed, but he makes his ways known to us. Our ability to know God and his ways is dependent upon him showing himself to us. We can't know God otherwise. How do we know God? God came to reveal himself to us through Jesus Christ. The Word, Logos, Jesus, became flesh and dwelt among us, John says, and we beheld the glory of God the Father. That's what God did. He reveals himself to us. And so what we know about God is dependent upon him showing us. And that's one of the benefits we have here. He shows himself to us. God has compassion on those who fear him, who revere him. Verse 8 says, he is gracious to forgive. He's gracious to forgive. We've already talked about forgiveness. The greatest benefit to us is his forgiveness. But he continues to forgive us. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, a familiar verse probably to many of us, but it's worth mentioning and it's worth digesting. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. To cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And you know, it doesn't just end there, but it goes on to the second chapter of 1 John, first verse. And John wrote these things that we would not sin. He doesn't want us to sin. God does not want us to sin. Paul even said, should we go on sinning so that grace may abound? God forbid. No, that's not what we do. As followers of Jesus, we don't try to sin. We don't want to sin. When we do sin, we are grieved by our own sin. We should be. But John said, write these things that we might not sin, but if we do, we have an advocate. We have someone who goes to bat for us with the Father. And Jesus sitting at their Father's right hand right now. When you or I sin, and we will, we do, Jesus says to the Father, remember, Dad. Remember, Dad, I went to the cross for her. I went to the cross for him. I endured the pain and the suffering. I shed my blood for that sin. And God says, okay. Okay, then. In my eyes, she's justified. He's justified. Just as if he never sinned. Just as if he never sinned. It's taken away. It's taken away. He is slow to anger and abounding in mercy and love. You see, in the Old Testament, many times when people disobeyed God, God's judgment was immediate, swift. But in the New Testament, we find that God's patient. He's patient. He's slow to anger. And mercy was great and grace was free. Mercy there was applied to me at Calvary. He removes our transgressions from us. Verse 12 says that as far as the east is from the west, so far have our transgressions been removed from us. Now think about that, folks. Think about this. Every sin you've ever committed, every sin that you've committed years ago, prior to our conversion experience, all that kind of stuff, every sin you've committed yesterday or this morning, or maybe even since you've been here, every sin he has removed from us as far as the east is from the west. How far is that? Let me just give you a geography lesson here. If you start at the equator and you travel north, you keep traveling all the way to the North Pole. But when you get to the North Pole and keep going, you start traveling south. And you continue south until you get to the South Pole. If you keep going, then you start traveling north again. The north and the south are, as far as the north is from the south, is only as far as the circumference of the earth. However, if you start at the prime meridian, and you start going east, and you get all the way around the earth to the prime meridian, you are still going east. And if you do this the rest of eternity, you are still going east. East never meets west. As far as the east is from the west, that far, he has removed our sins from us. Isn't that exciting? Man, we ought to be just elated. That's even a lame word this morning. We should be so excited and thrilled that he has removed our sin that far from us. And on top of all of that, as he winds down this song, David says, he knows our weaknesses. He knows that we are weak. We have frail bodies. He formed us. How did Adam come into being? He took a handful of dirt, the dust of the earth, and he formed a man and breathed the breath of life into him, and he became the first human on earth. That's how he formed us. And he knows, as well as anybody, that our bodies are frail. They get sick, they can't always lift as much weight as they would like, they, you know, all kinds of things, we're frail. But he's made a covenant with us. In spite of all of this, God has said, I love you with an everlasting love. He lavishes, Paul said, he lavishes his love upon us. And his love, his covenant love, extends to the generations. Extends to our children and to our grandchildren and to our grandchildren's children and go on down the line. It extends to all generations. Now verses 19 to 22 are interesting as we conclude this morning. They tell us that the Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. My God is on the throne, amen? My God is bigger than inflation. Our God is bigger than politics. My God is bigger than COVID-19 or any other virus they want to throw at us. My God is bigger and greater because my God has never and never will abdicate his throne in heaven. He is still on the throne. Hallelujah. He rules over all. And David said, the angels in heaven, that's not us, the angels in heaven bless the Lord. They bless the Lord. The heavenly hosts, they bless the Lord. And then he says, all creation, that is us. That's you and me. All creation blesses the Lord. And we find in the very last of the Psalms, 150th, the very last verse, he writes, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for speaking into our lives. We continue to ask the Holy Spirit to make it real to us, that we carry it from by moment, day by day. In Jesus' name we pray.